Well, it's that time of the year again when we get the next major update for Android. This new version is Android 8.0, also called Oreo, and has a lot of new features that I'm actually really excited about, and a couple things I'm not so sure about. But in any case, we're gonna take a look at 15 of the best changes with this new update, including some major changes and small changes as well. Now, as usual, before we begin, I wanna give a quick 2-second plug to my Instagram and Twitter accounts. I try to post cool stuff on there, so if you wanna check those out, they're both just at TheoJoe. But anyway, let's get going. Okay, starting off, one of the first big changes people will notice in Android 8.0 is that they completely redesigned all the emojis. The blobs are no more, and now we have circle emojis just like all the other platforms. I've talked about this in other videos before and how I think the new emojis are pretty darn ugly actually, and I'm all for making them consistent with other platforms like iOS, that makes sense, but to me they just look poorly designed with weird gradients and thick outlines, and of course we'll never forget the most upsetting casualty, the turtle, who has now been replaced with this ugly beast. But anyways, for some reason, a lot of people actually do seem to like these new emojis, so it looks like we're not gonna get rid of them anytime soon. Moving on, the next few are some significant new features all having to do with notifications. So for number two, we have the new notification dots. Now on the home screen in the app drawer, whenever an app has an active notification, it will show a dot in the corner of the icon to signify just that, that you have a new notification. And if you've ever used an iPhone before, this feature will probably seem very familiar because iOS has had the same feature for years, except it would show a number. Also, another cool thing is that you can long press on the app icon and it will show you a shortened preview of the notification, so you don't have to click into them every time. The one thing I'm not too sure about though is that the notification dots apparently only show when you also have a notification in the notification bar dropdown as well. So it seems pretty redundant that it would show in both. Like, why do you need the dot if it's already showing up there? I don't know, still, they might make changes to how they work at some point. We'll have to wait and see. On to number three, you now have the ability to snooze notifications. This is something I've been waiting for a long time. So when you get a new notification, you now partially swipe it to the side, which will reveal two symbols, a gear, which takes you to the notification settings, and now a clock symbol. If you press the clock, it will remove the notification for a certain amount of time, which you can adjust by clicking in the dropdown. So it's either 15 minutes, 30 minutes, 1 hour, or 2 hours. Then once the time is up, the notification will come back. So this is great for stuff that you can't deal with at the moment, or maybe you just don't want to. Okay, next up is the new so-called notification channels. And this basically just means you can now customize how certain notifications can behave for certain apps. For example, whether an app can create notifications that vibrate the phone, or play a sound, or show on the lock screen, that sort of thing. This is ideal for apps that you might like to get notifications from, but maybe they're not urgent, so you don't need them to vibrate and play a noise, you just wanna see that it's there the next time you use your phone. To adjust these channels, you can navigate to an app through the settings window, or if you get a notification, you can partially swipe and click the gear this time, and then more settings, and it will bring you there. All right, number five, here's a cool one, picture in picture. This one is a pretty big deal, I think, you probably think so too. For certain apps like YouTube or VLC Media Player, if you're watching a video and you press the home button, the video will keep playing and minimize to a small window and stay on top. And it will stay like this even if you open up and start using other apps. If you want, you can drag around the window, and if you tap it, you'll see options to pause, go to the next video, close it, or go back to viewing it in the original app. Pretty awesome. Number six, instant apps. This feature will allow you to run certain apps without having to download them from the Play Store. So how it works is someone might make an instant app hosted on their website. So when you go to a certain URL, it appears and brings up the app then. This way, you can get more functionality than just a regular mobile page, and you don't have to actually go make people download it. So it's almost like a super mobile web page in that it can do a lot more than a regular web page, but maybe not as much as a real app. So yeah, obviously I'm sure that these will have less abilities than one you would be able to download and install for obvious reasons, but it is perfect for maybe giving users a better experience from your website without having them doing anything. And also, these instant apps will be backwards compatible with Android versions 6.0 and later. About halfway through now, number 7 is smart text selection. Android will now use AI to try and predict what parts of text you're trying to select when you double tap something. So if you double tap on an address, it's smart enough to hopefully realize you probably want to select the whole address. Same for a phone number. But it apparently will also work for less obvious things like the name of restaurants. So if your friend texts you, "We're going to Bob's Pizza Joint," if you double tap that name, it should theoretically highlight Bob's Pizza Joint. Also, now when you highlight certain types of text, it will give you a shortcut right there to open a related app. So if you highlight an address, it will give you the option to search it in Google Maps. Same goes for a phone number with the phone app. So that will definitely be useful, and if the smart text selection works as well as they claim, that should be pretty cool too. All right, the next change is that apps will now be limited in how much storage they can use for their data cache. This is more of a background feature, so I can't really show you, but it's still important. I think you guys are gonna like it. As you know, any app you use will store certain data in a cache so it's quickly accessible later, as opposed to having to download it every time. But sometimes app caches get really bloated and take up a ton of storage. So now Android O will be able to manage this data. And I don't think there will be a specific hard limit for everything, like this amount and that's it forever, but it'll rather change depending on the situation. Like if you have 128 gigabytes of storage, it will let apps have a little bit bigger cache. Or if you start to run out of space, it will start clearing out some of that cache. Not something that will be obvious, but still helpful in the background. Number 9, it's very simple. Apps will now be able to use gestures using the fingerprint sensor. Assuming you have one that can detect gestures, developers will now be able to let users swipe either vertically or horizontally on the fingerprint sensor, which would then do something. Before, this basically only worked for system apps, and I think it was only on Pixel and Nexus phones as well, but now you should start to see it on others too. Moving on, number 10, you'll now have the option to have Android automatically turn your Wi-Fi on and off depending on whether you're near a saved Wi-Fi network. And this feature should help you save both cellular data and battery life. For example, when you're away from home, the Wi-Fi radio will be off, using less battery, and when you're at home, it will turn on the Wi-Fi so you're not using as much cell data. I'm not totally sure how it detects whether you're within range, but I'm guessing it's either location-based with GPS, or it could be periodic background scans, or even a combination of both. Next up, we have some updates to the battery usage menu. Like before, you can see which apps used how much power and a graph of battery over time if you tap on the battery now. But it doesn't show system battery usage like from the screen or cellular data. To change that, you now have to tap on the three dots in the corner and you'll see a new option to show full device usage. So now, instead of just showing apps usage, it will show you system usage as well, such as screen, the OS itself, and phone idle. This obviously isn't a new feature, but I figured I should point it out because a lot of people will be wondering why they can't see all the battery stats. But one thing I think is new is when you click on an app, it now shows you how long the app has been running in the background. So you can spot apps that may be using up data or battery when you're not even using it. Okay, the 12th new feature is called Rescue Party. Kind of a funny name, but it could be super helpful. This is another one of the behind the scenes features built into Android, and it's meant to protect your phone against boot loops and repeated crashes. How it works is if your phone reboots 5 times within 5 minutes from repeated crashes, obviously, the operating system will automatically start applying fixes to solve it. It begins with simple things like clearing the data cache, but if it keeps crashing, we'll start applying more drastic fixes each time. Eventually, if it tries everything and it's still doing it, it will ask you if you want to actually factory reset your phone. Though, me personally, I would probably still want to try and search for my own ways to potentially fix it before deciding to wipe the whole thing. And hopefully it doesn't get to that point though. Number 13, something so simple that I've been asking for forever. Stock Android now shows the battery percentage next to the battery in the status bar. I mean, yes, before you could have the percentage show up on the battery icon, but it was so small you could barely see it. So thank you, Google. Seriously, what took you so long? Okay, so coming near the end, 14 is actually a pretty big feature, which is a whole new Autofill API. What that means is now there is native support for certain apps to be able to autofill forms no matter what app you're using it in. And you can choose what app is the one that can do this by changing the default autofill service. It's a new setting. And if you're still confused, one example is if you have a password manager like LastPass or Google's own autofill service with Smart Lock. With these, when you go to a login page for any app, that app can now automatically fill it in with your login data or data for your credit card or whatever. And before, you had to jump through all sorts of hoops and give these apps special accessibility permissions and whatnot, but now it's all built in. This should also improve battery life because those apps no longer have to constantly run in the background and scan for fillable forms, so this should be really useful. And finally, number 15 is also very simple, and that is the nightlight feature now has a slider so you can actually choose the intensity of the effect. This is something, if you've been watching my videos, you know I've been asking for forever. I'd honestly wish they would let you shift it even more so like you can with iOS, but I'll take what I can get. And so we're done. Those are some of the best new features I've come across in Android 8, but of course there are others I didn't mention. If I missed any big ones, I'm sure you guys will let me know in the comments. If you want to keep watching, I've got some other videos I think you'll enjoy right here. And if you want to subscribe, I make a few new videos every week. Also consider enabling notifications too, or else YouTube probably won't even show you the new videos anyway. So I'm looking forward to hearing from you guys, and I'll see you next time. Have a good one.